This material is intended for general informational purposes only and does not constitute legal advice. The law varies by jurisdiction and is constantly changing. For legal advice, you should consult a lawyer that can apply the appropriate law to the facts in your case. Aloha, I'm Coralie Chun Matayoshi, and welcome to my legal podcast, What's the Law? Each week, you will learn valuable information about various legal topics to help you get through life's ups and downs, and even when things go sideways. So stay tuned. Now with me is Jeffrey Harris. He's a director of the Torklidson Katz Law Firm. He has over 40 years of experience advising businesses and nonprofits about all aspects of labor and employment law, including compliance, labor relations, workplace safety, discrimination, and harassment claims. Welcome, Jeff.
Good seeing you, Coralie. Thank you for having me.
So employers have the duty to provide a safe environment for workers. Sounds simple, but there are different types of threats coming from all different directions. What is the definition of workplace violence?
Workplace violence is really any act or threat of violence, harassment, intimidation, or other threatening behavior at the worksite. And sometimes even out of the worksite, if it relates to the working relationship. It ranges from threats, verbal abuse, to physical assaults, and even homicide. It may involve employees, clients, customers, and visitors. And the examples range from, hey, brah, you want a beef? Up to a murder. That's all workplace violence.
Mm-hmm. And what factors increase workplace violence, the risk of it?
Well, a number of factors increase the risk of workplace violence, exchanging money with the public, working with volatile, unstable people, alone or in isolated areas, providing services and care, working where alcohol is served, working late at night or in areas with high crime rates, working alone or in small groups.
So in light of the alarming rate of mass shootings, the United States Secret Service National Threat Assessment Center recently issued a report recommending that businesses establish a workplace violence prevention plans to identify, assess, and intervene with current employees, former employees, customers, and others who might pose a risk of violence. How should businesses go about doing this?
We recommend that employers prepare a written zero tolerance workplace policy against workplace violence, covering all workers, patients, clients, visitors, contractors, and anyone else that any of those people may come in contact with. Then employers should assess work sites and identify methods for reducing the likelihood of incidents, including engineering controls such as our back doors at the office are locked now, administrative controls such as restricting unauthorized entry, and training employees to recognize the risk and avoid it.
Should they equip them with like cell phones or institute buddy systems if people are in isolated areas?
Yes, yes. As a matter of fact, several of the late night stores have installed not only cameras, those have been around for a long time, but call trees. Where people can promptly call either a security firm or a manager to marshal resources.
Like the panic button, right?
Yeah.
So what if an employee starts acting strange, like they get aggressive or they start talking about guns or something like that? You can't force them to go to employee assistant programs like therapy. What can you do?
You shouldn't force them to go to an EAP because that would show that you regard them as disabled. You should instead explain that the employee should leave the work site, go see their healthcare provider with a letter that you provide identifying the concerning conduct, and ask the doctor to ask the healthcare provider to verify, in other words, swear that the employee is able to perform the functions of the position without danger to him or herself or others.
What if the employee says, there's nothing wrong with me, I don't want to go? What can you do then?
Stay home.
You can stay home, and
you should have sound ground to defend against any unemployment claim. If you document the threatening behavior.
So what if the employee violates your zero tolerance policy? What steps can the employer take, and can you fire them?
I typically recommend discharge if you have a documented behavior by somebody that's personally observed it, and unless there's some explanation or excuse allowing another chance. And I don't mean I got mad, he or she did the wrong thing to me. The times that we've seen an explanation or excuse have been, it was an accident. I was cussing to myself and I didn't know anybody else was around. But other than that, if you have a zero tolerance policy, you should publish it and you should implement it.
And you should have them sign that they know about this policy, right?
Yeah, that's a good idea. But as long as you've shown that it was published in the workplace, every employee is bound by it.
So how can an employer screen applicants for potential workplace violence tendencies before they hire them? I know you can't ask questions about mental health and things like that. What can you do?
You can check a criminal conviction record post offer. You can have a medical exam post offer. And if there's a record of violence in the last 10 years, in the case of a criminal conviction, if it's rationally related, that can enter into your decision. So, and by rationally related, I mean violence acts that would translate over into your workplace.
Or like if you had a sexual assault conviction and you're dealing with children or something, that's rationally related, right?
Correct.
So the offer would be contingent upon the results of a post-conviction record query.
Yes, both criminal convictions and medical healthcare reviews require the offer to be given conditioned on the post-offer exam.
And what if someone is injured in the workplace because of violence? Can they sue the employer or business if they're like a customer or employee?
Employees have workers' compensation. But workers' compensation doesn't shield managers who work at the employer that can be alleged to willfully and wantonly involve the risk. That willful and wantonly not adopted workplace violence, zero tolerance workplace violence policy. Willful and wantonly left the back door open. Willful and wantonly left a young kid that hasn't been trained about risks in a volatile situation. And and customers, clients, customers, non-employees, may sue the company directly and claim that the company is vicariously liable for the employee's acts. And that's even if those acts are forbidden, as long as they were taken in the scope of the employment.
So there doesn't have to be any knowledge or acquiescence on the part of the employer as long as it's done.
No, and as a matter of fact, you could have a zero tolerance policy. You could train the employee not to threaten customers. A customer could walk in, the employee could punch the customer, and the employer would be liable, likely exposed to being liable, because the employee was engaged with a customer in the workplace and punched. Even if you said you can't punch people.
So in June of 2022, the United States Supreme Court expanded the Second Amendment to prevent the government from restricting the right to carry guns in public. If business like a restaurant allows customers to bring guns into their restaurant, isn't this making the workplace more dangerous for employees?
If there's a gun in there, it could be discharged. So to that extent, it does make it more dangerous wherever there's a gun in place. Nothing prevents, but let me underscore, nothing prevents a private business from barring guns in their workplace. And what New York did after the Supreme Court acted is they passed what is called the Concealed Carry Improvements Act. That's something that I recommend that our state legislature think about doing. But we don't have to wait for the state legislature. We don't allow guns or knives or drugs or anything else in our workplace. And any private employer can do that. The real question is it involves the public sector and the courts, administrative agencies, mm-hmm. other public buildings, they can probably get away with under the Bruin case with restricting guns in those locations. All the Supreme Court said is New York could not bar somebody from carrying a gun out in public. Mm-hmm. And so that question needs to be refined by our judicial system. But meanwhile, there's absolutely no reason that I can think that a restaurant would want to allow somebody to bring a gun into their facility, unless, of course, it's the friendly officer that is coming in for some donuts or something.
Right. And I believe that the legislature does have some bills restricting guns in sensitive places. And that's a wrap. We want to thank Jeff Harris for his time and expertise. And thank you for joining us on What's the Law. Until next time, ahui ho.